Good afternoon, everyone. Please be seated. On behalf of the University of Strathclyde, I would like to welcome you to the Barony Hall for this congregation for the conferment of degrees. This is a day of celebration for you, our graduates, your families and friends, and for the staff of the university. In the United States, they call these events commencement ceremonies, as a signal that they mark a beginning rather than the end. And it's in that spirit that we celebrate graduations here at Strathclyde. In a few moments, it will be my privilege to cap each graduand. The capping ceremony has ancient roots as a public rite of passage and a mark of achievement. For each of our graduands, it's a sign that they are part of a tradition of scholars at Strathclyde, stretching back to the Scottish Enlightenment. Enjoy the ceremony. I declare this congregation open and invite Professor David Littlejohn to the stage to present our honorary graduand.
My Lord and Chancellor, I have the honor to present to you Professor Bertil Anderson, President of Nanyang Technological University, Singapore. Scientist, visionary, educationalist, advisor to governments, international academic leader, and selector of Nobel Prize winners. Bertil Anderson's contributions in each of these roles are exceptional, and it will be difficult to do justice to all of them in this short oration. There can be no doubt, however, that he has made significant and enduring contributions in all his endeavors. Bertil Anderson was born on 30th of May 1948 in Finspång, Sweden. He grew up in what we would call a working class family. His father worked in the aluminium industry, and family life was simple, with no prior connection to academia or to research. At school, Bertil demonstrated an aptitude for science, and it was no surprise that he went to university, gaining BSc and MSc degrees from Umeå University in the early 1970s. Bertil was the first person in his family to go to university and is forever grateful that he grew up in a country where progression in education depended on ability and not wealth, a philosophy we also value in this country. In 1974, Bertil left Umeå and moved to Lund University, where he graduated PhD in biochemistry in 1978 and DSc in 1982. It was during this period that Bertil began discipline-changing contributions in the field of photosynthesis, conducting research which was to have a profound influence on our understanding of the biomolecular processes which occur in plant cells in response to light. Some of his published research was highly controversial at the time, as it contradicted accepted paradigms of the day. However, Anderson's theories eventually became accepted and are now illustrated in many textbooks in biochemistry, molecular and cellular biology, as well as plant physiology. This period in Bertil's career reveals not only a brilliant scientist who was able to change the ways biochemists thought about aspects of photosynthesis, but also demonstrates a man who was not afraid to challenge the status quo and think in new ways, characteristics that have persisted and been demonstrated throughout his illustrious career. Following the award of his PhD, Bertil Anderson remained for a while at Lund before moving in 1986 to Stockholm University to the professorial chair of biochemistry, a post he held until 2003. While at Stockholm, Bertil not only built an impressive scientific career that has resulted in 300 publications, mainly in photosynthesis research, but it is also where he began to demonstrate his abilities as an academic leader. Firstly, as head of biochemistry, and then as dean of chemical sciences and pro-dean of the science faculty. His abilities in academic management attracted attention at Finspång University, and he was appointed rector or president there in 1993. In 2003, Stockholm tried to lure Bertil back as their rector, which would have been a logical, if somewhat conventional, career move to make. But this is another point in Bertil's career where he decided not to follow convention, and he moved in 2004 to the post of Chief Executive Officer of the European Science Foundation in Strasbourg. While as head of the ESF, Bertil increased the profile of high-level European research and research policy, and was one of the driving forces behind the establishment of the European Research Council, which has supported and developed the careers of many of Europe's finest scientists and engineers, including a number of my colleagues at Strathclyde. Then came another career move that most would not have predicted, for instead of assuming a senior role in a Swedish or other European university, Bertil moved to Singapore to become provost of Nanyang Technological University in 2007, and then was appointed as the president of the university in 2011. NTU has thrived under Bertil's leadership. In the recent Times Higher Education League tables, the university is ranked 61st worldwide, 10th in Asia, and features in the top three Asian technological universities. Professor Anderson has enhanced NTU's and Singapore's engagement with a host of top institutions and companies in the United Kingdom. Rolls-Royce and Johnson Matthey are two examples, laying the foundation for important collaborations. NTU enjoys particularly close relations with the University of Strathclyde. A large number of prominent staff of NTU are alumni of Strathclyde. And in 2013, the university signed a framework agreement for collaboration in a number of areas of research, including pharmaceutical systems. Bertil's appreciation of the help and support he received as a young scholar in Sweden has had a significant impact on his willingness to give something back to society. He has served on the boards of several Swedish and international foundations and learned societies, and has had a long-standing association with the Nobel Foundation, serving as a member and then chairman of the Nobel Prize Committee for Chemistry, and subsequently a trustee of the Nobel Foundation. It is also not by chance that Bertil has encouraged socially relevant research while as president of NTU. In recognition of his achievements and many contributions, Bertil Anderson has received numerous awards and prizes. He holds honorary degrees from universities in four continents, received the Educational Merit Award from the World Cultural Council, and in 2010 was awarded the prestigious Wilhelm Exner Medal in Vienna, joining an illustrious band of scientists, including several Nobel Prize winners. This award is given to a select few who have shaped the world through research. And in Bertil's case, this was for his pioneering work relating to artificial leaves, a promising area of sustainable energy research that uses sunlight to produce clean, low-cost sources of energy. Joining Bertil today, we're pleased to welcome his wife, Susanna, also an academic at NTU, and his colleagues, Tony Mayer, Lewis Fee, and David Lee Butler, and also a visiting professor at NTU, Brian Arthur, and his partner, Dr. Gwag Bison. We are delighted you are all able to be with us on this special occasion. Despite all his achievements, Bertil Anderson is at heart a family man and a loyal colleague who is able to enjoy the lighter side of life. I'm told he loves to read historical books and is an expert in rock and pop music. At NTU, Bertil and his provost, Professor Freddy Boy, are renowned for their singing double act to the great delight of students and staff. No doubt the songs of ABBA feature prominently in their repertoire. So there you have it. Bertil Anderson is a visionary scientist and academic leader, but also an intensely human and inspiring individual, a man from a humble background who has achieved great things. It is with immense pleasure, therefore, my Lord and Chancellor, that with the authority of Senate, I ask you to confer upon Professor Bertil Anderson the degree of Doctor of the University honoris causa.
I create you Doctor of the University honoris causa. Congratulations.
Fantastic.
Chancellor, Principal, fellow graduates, parents, ladies and gentlemen, let me first express my sincere appreciation and gratefulness to receive an honorary degree here at University of Strathclyde in Glasgow. Of course, it's always an honor to be honored, and an honorary degree is certainly not and exceptions. As you learned from the presentation, which was quite positive, I don't know if my wife recognized me actually, but I'm a Swede from the Arctic Stockholm and now in tropical Singapore, and in between I worked in Strasbourg on European research matters. And today I am receiving an honorary degree in Scotland from the University of Strathclyde, so no doubt, as you realize, S is my lucky letter, right? So, but you have to realize, I'm actually not the first Swede who has received a prestigious Strathclyde honorary degree, because in 2005, a real Swedish giant was receiving his degree here on this very stage. And I'm, of course, referring to Henrik Larsson, the iconic goal scorer, not only for the Swedish national team, but also for Celtic, right? And you heard that I come from quite a simple background. And you see, my relatives back in Sweden, they don't have so much feeling for academic traditions and degree ceremonies. But if I can say when I come home later on this week that I have received the same award as Henrik Larsson, wow, they will be very proud, I can tell you. Well, an honorary degree is, of course, a recognition of an individual, but also many times a way to highlight a long-term partnership and cooperation between academic institutions. And I feel that this aspect is particularly relevant here today. University of Strathclyde and Nanyang Technological University, NTU, have had close links for several decades, going back to the very early 1990s. Those were early days of academic development for the young nation Singapore. It's actually founded as late as 1965 and celebrates its 50 years jubilee this year. And many young Singaporeans at that time received their academic education abroad. And many students were, for example, sent to Strathclyde by the Singapore government to get their degrees in engineering. So why Strathclyde? Well, in Singapore, it was recognized that University of Strathclyde represented a more hands-on, practical, and industrial relevant engineering than most other UK universities. And that was what this new nation in Asia needed at that time. I estimate, and you heard the presenter say, that NTU, there have been about 50 professors in engineering that has received their academic degree from Strathclyde. And to this day, we have, I think, 27 Strathclyde alumni as our professors. Not bad, right? But what is important is that the strong ties between Strathclyde and NTU is not history. It's really, if it's history, it's living history, because it's developing every day. Strathclyde is NTU's main partner in the UK for student exchange. This year, more than 50 NTU students went from Singapore to Glasgow and vice versa. When I work on the campus, I can hear a lot of Scottish accents, I can tell you that. You know. And furthermore, in 2013, we signed an MOU for academic exchange and research in areas such as advanced manufacturing and energy. I think it's fair to say that Strathclyde and NTU has remained academic soulmates across the globe and through the decades. And I think that is really fantastic, and I'm ever so proud to be part of this collaboration. Of course, even more as an honorary doctor, right? It's, however, clear that my honor here today is totally overrun by all the circa 200 students here that are present this afternoon. Your hard work and determination have now given fruit. Today, you are Strathclyde student, but very soon, you are turning into Strathclyde alumni. You are moving on in life. I don't know if I am in the position to give you any words of wisdom on the way, but let me share with you some of my experiences. As you heard, I'm now working in Singapore as the Vice Chancellor of NTU, but I also worked in many other countries like UK, France, Israel, and Australia. But also, my destiny was absolutely not to become a well-known professor and live an international life. As I said, and you heard it, my family background in Sweden and my relatives had no intention that I would study at university. And I wasn't out of Sweden until I was 20 years of age. In the end, my own drive and ambition made me go to university. And, as you also heard, it was only because education in Sweden was entirely free, otherwise I had never made it. So I'm very delighted to see that Scotland have the same practice, which I think is a very good one. So my first smart decision was to, against all odds, start university. My second smart decision, I hope I made a few more, but my second smart decision was to start a PhD. And that was really follow my inner voice, the passion, and do research, and actually move the frontiers of our knowledge. And so my research has been on photosynthesis, and we got a very good recollection of that. And of course, plants are really the smart ones. They can use light, they can use carbon dioxide and water, and they have the perfect machinery, the perfect solar cell. And I sometimes feel I'm an industrial spy who tried to find out the blueprint behind this magic process that keeps our nature going. And you remember, in modern society, we have energy crisis. Nature doesn't have any energy crisis because of photosynthesis. Let me also, before I close, thank all parents for the support of their daughters and son. I can look out here in the audience and I see many parents here. And the dedicated support from mums and dads is very crucial during the university years. And only 4 years ago, I was sitting out there in the audience seeing my daughters graduate, and I was really proud. And needless to say, we also have many teachers here this afternoon. Not any teachers, Strathclyde teachers. And they, of course, provided knowledge and inspiration for our current graduates. Finally, returning to all our graduates, good luck in the future. Believe in yourself, be visionary, work hard, but also try to keep a balance in life. And let me give you a final quote. You do not want to walk on other person's footsteps. You want to create your own. This quote is from no one else than Henrik Larsson, soccer player and honorary doctor at Strathclyde. So, I think the two Swedish honorary doctors at Strathclyde thinks the same. No more quotes, But just let me express how grateful I am for this honor that has been bestowed on me today. Thank you.
My Lord and Chancellor, in the name of the University and by the authority of Senate, I present to you these students. For the degree of Master of Pharmacy in Pharmacy, Gillian Louise McQuilter Agnew. Sunya Ali. Ba Yi Wei. Jessica Bogle. Christopher Boyle. Joseph Matthew Brayson. Rachel Ann Byers. Fiona Samantha Caldwell. Matthew Christie. Gillian Clark. Fiona Ansi Jean Clid. Laura Elizabeth Davidson. Neil Davidson. Anne Finlayson. Chi Seng Fong. Julie Elizabeth Handley. Emma Hendry. Heng Mok Hong. Sarah Louise Hill. Hoi Kuan Yi. Kirsten Donalda Hunter. Rachel Jeffrey. Tina Johnson. Wei Nian Kang. Lian Ko Wei Wen. Jade Jang Kirkpatrick. Leon Jit Chi. Lu Wan Yi. Amanda McCabe. Jennifer McClintock. Zoe McGroarty. Lucy Margaret McKindley. Lauren McKinnon. Gillian Maguire. Emily Moriarty. Wan Ling Ng. Ong Ru Yen Brenda. Wee Kiat Le. Sivya P. Sandran. Jennifer Rose Perry. Catherine Margaret Richardson. Emma Russell. Hannah Louise Seal. C. G. Jia. Laura Jefferson Shill. Jane Leslie Stewart. Tan Wei Yen. Kai Shen Te. Kara Wark. Jennifer Watton. Catherine Jennifer Watt. Douglas Scott Wilkinson. Sue Hui Yong. Deborah Claire Yule. Usman Amin. Umbika Kyor Urk. Makrina Aziz. Simon Patrick Derek Bailey. Lucy Elizabeth Bannatyne. Emma Bain. Fiona Bertram. Sarah Nora Busuara. Emma Boyle. Sarah Burgess. David Robert Carter. Chai Ching Yi. Chan Hui Ching. Chan Mei Chi. Chan Su Thing. Tian Kang Chia. Teresa Chong Wen San. Chao Xin Ying. Rachel Eve Clapham. Scott James Conlon. John Francis Craig. Mary Cromarty. Carolyn Catherine Cuthbert. Roderick John Duncan. Izu Z. Jusrin. David Fancourt. Camelia Nikolaeva Fitkova. Fu Su Pieng. Chu Yi Go. Julie Green. Ghazal Hamid. Amy Hanna. Fiza Hack. Matthew Hislop. Tracy Hao Zi Cheng. Marcella Elise Hoi Volpe. Maryam Ismail. Maheen Ijaz Jabbar. Kevin Brian Jones. Kua Fan Yu. Wahi Wen Kwan. Loi Wei Chan. Prima Le Chu Manan. Cheryl Lee Wei Shan. Su Mun Lee. Adam James Peter Leslie. Lim Ho Yen. Wendy Loy Ting Ting. Jonathan David Loudon. Lo Kuan Teng. Lo Su Chin. Yuan Er Lo. Lua Sin Hui. Anthony Luby. Gillian Janet McCafferty. Thomas McIntosh. Ross James McCarroll. Hannah Claire McLeod. Elsa Elizabeth McNaughton. Alice Jean Yin Maha. Balwin Kaur Manvinder Singh. Aisha Marwaha. Thomas Walter Mund. Helena Alexandra Mills. Caroline Deborah Mitchell. Asghad Muhammad Ali. Nicola Moultrie. Rachel Catherine Murdoch. Roshwini Envis Muthaya. Beng Huen Neo. Ing Chuen So Yo. Ing Ki Hong. Min Yi Ing. Ing Shang Yin. Ing Su Ying. Sweat Ying Ing. Ing Xing Wei. Ong Li Jian. Colleen Patterson. Kelly Patterson. Eddie Wing Kit Fang. Nicola Jane Perry. Gavin Postlethwaite. Navnina Kaur Poor. Anissa quick, shitty time. Hassan Rashid. Lily Bethan Roper. Dariush Savafi. Dora Sarungi. Omer Shaba. Louise Small. Liam Andrew Smith. Jean Elizabeth Stapleton. Ainsley Steele. Sean Thomas William Steele. Fiona Mary Strang. Mitsuhiko Suzuki. Nawar Safa Tahir. Tan Guat Min. Te Shin Hoi. Tio K. Hoi. Tio Chow Ying. Jenny Blair Thistleton. Yi Jian Tiong. To Ke Shan. Tung Mei Yin. Jack Whitelaw. Heather Elizabeth Rotten. Yao Fui Wan. Yi Hui Yuan. Elaine Young Lee Ern. Shireen Ali. Ashur. Nicola Berkeley. Gavin Carr. Rory Laverty. William Simon Lee. Nicholas McLean. Aisha Mahmood. Othniel Uy Jin Wahat. Te Yi Yi. Ruxar Anam Ula. Gerard Thomas Williamson. For the degree of Master in Science in Pharmacy International, Wang He Lun. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Pharmaceutical Sciences, Dana Louise Duffy. Maria Caterina Ianiello. Andrew Wong Xuan Chi.
Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, but most of all, our graduates. It's a real pleasure to welcome you here to the Barony Hall, one of the jewels in Strathclyde's crown. Rightly, our graduates have been center stage, and I would like to begin my address today by congratulating you once again on your academic achievements. Your hard work has paid off, and it's now been recognized in front of your families, friends, and the staff who taught and supported you during your time here. Graduation is one of the great moments in a university's year. This is a proud day for you and for us all. Well done. In just a few minutes' time, you will be asked to join the academic procession as it leaves the Barony Hall. This invitation symbolizes the fact you're no longer students, but full members of the academic community of Strathclyde. It's an important moment for you all. There's something special about being a member of a Strathclyde family, something special about belonging to a community of people who've come together in a pursuit of knowledge and of friendship. I know that the memory of today is something that will stay with you wherever you go and whatever you choose to do in life. We will keep in touch with you through our alumni team, but I would ask you too to keep in touch with us. Let us know what you're up to, what you think about what we are doing, and what you would like to do to help future generations of students in the way that graduates from previous generations have helped you. As Strathclyde graduates, you possess one of the most valuable assets anyone can have in today's world, and that's the ability to absorb knowledge and the capacity to use it for the good of yourselves, your community, and the wider world. The late Nelson Mandela said, "Education was the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world." Do not underestimate its power, and do not forget your responsibility to use it well. In Scotland, we are fortunate in having a higher education system, which is the envy of the world. Our country has the resources to provide mass education, and as a society, we are absolutely right to invest in it. Globally, it's a different picture. We are the lucky ones, members of a small, educated elite, our minds finely tuned in the lecture theatre, the laboratory, and the library. But that distinction brings us no additional rights. We're all members of one common humanity, educated or uneducated, rich or poor. If education does not confer rights, the opportunity education gives each of us carries with it a duty to use what we've learned wisely and for the good of others. A sense of duty comes easily to graduates of this university. As Strathclyders, we only have to look to the achievements of those who've gone before us for inspiration. To John Anderson, our founder, who established this university for the good of mankind. To George Birkbeck, who introduced free classes on mechanics for Glasgow's tradesmen. To the world's first oilman, James Paraffin Young. To the missionary and explorer, David Livingstone. To John Logie Baird and Lord Reith, whose work in television brought us visual marvels that they could hardly have dreamt of. In the present day, we look to Dame Eilish Angiolini, a pioneer in Scottish justice as the country's first female Solicitor General and later its first female Lord Advocate, and to Sir Tom Hunter, one of the most successful entrepreneurs in Scottish history and a philanthropist who's used his wealth to great benefit of others around the world. Now, I'm sure you'll have been given lots of advice on how to make the best of your lives. Some of that advice you will rightly ignore. Some will stick with you, but you know, most of it you're going to have to learn for yourself. There's a saying that we're all paid in two types of banknote. One is cash and the other's experience. Always take the experience first. The money will come later. Robert Louis Stevenson put it well when he said, "Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds that you plant." To reach this point in your lives today, each of you will have traveled a different journey. For some, the path will have been relatively easy. For others, more difficult. But I'm certain of one thing. None of you would be where you are now without the active support of your family and friends. They've picked you up when you've been down. They've encouraged you when you needed it. They've even been willing to take in your dirty laundry. They are celebrating today, not just because you're almost off the payroll, but because you carry their hopes and dreams, their confidence you can make this a better world. Now, for the past half hour or so, their applause has rung in your ears as you cross this stage. I'd like to invite our graduates now to show their appreciation for the support of their family and friends. Now, I touched earlier on some of the key figures who've helped create the University of Strathclyde. And you can tell a lot about the values of an organization by looking at its roots. Strathclyde traces its lineage back to 1796, when Anderson brought it into being, the only Scottish university founded in the Enlightenment and embodying Enlightenment principles of reason, tolerance, and equality. Anderson believed in useful learning, And his commitment to taking knowledge and using it for the greater good is the motivating force which gives Strathclyde its momentum today. Indeed, it was our demonstration of that commitment which helped us to win the title of Times Higher Entrepreneurial University of the Year in 2013 and the UK University of the Year in 2012. The judges called the university bold, innovative, and imaginative, attributes which you, our latest graduates, embody. It can be seen at our Institute for Pharmacy and Biomedical Sciences, which is developing new medicines to combat some of those pernicious diseases of the modern age. It can be seen in a pioneering law clinic, where our students provide advice and representation to people who cannot afford legal advice. It can be seen in the Hunter Centre for Entrepreneurship and the Fraser of Allender Institute, which are contributing directly to the development of the Scottish economy. And it can be seen in our £89 million Technology and Innovation Centre. The centre officially opens this very week, in fact, tomorrow morning. And it's already transforming the way academics collaborate with business, industry, and the public sector to bring global competitive advantage to Scotland. The Technology and Innovation Centre is a tangible sign of the university's commitment to world-class research and ensuring outcomes that are maximum benefit to society and the economy. Now, these are just four examples from across the university. But for these four, I could give you another 44 examples of academics taking new knowledge and using it to solve problems in industry, in the classroom and in boardrooms. So too has it been a year to celebrate for the Faculty of Science. Strathclyde is now among the top 20 research-intensive universities in the UK, following the recent Research Excellence Framework. Of particular note is the physics department being ranked number one in the UK, beating competition from Oxford, Cambridge, and Imperial College. Researchers discovered a new test for meningitis, which would help deliver faster and more effective treatments for patients. Developed in the Department of Pure and Applied Chemistry, a spectroscopic imaging technique known as CERS makes it possible to test for three different types of bacteria, leading to faster and more effective treatment. And Strathclyde was the only UK higher education institution involved in four new quantum technology hubs, announced as part of a £270 million government investment programme. The university will play a key role in the national network of hubs, which will explore the properties of quantum mechanics and how they can be harnessed for use in technology ranging from GPS navigation systems to medical imaging to financial transactions to computing. Researchers in science are part of a new £4.2 million institute that will investigate the prevention and control of healthcare-associated infections. The Scottish Healthcare-Associated Infection Prevention Institute represents the largest single investment in research relating to these infections in Scotland. That is why our graduates are so highly prized by companies looking to recruit the best talent to drive their businesses forward. That is why world-class companies such as Rolls-Royce, Siemens, and Mitsubishi are investing in Strathclyde. And that is why we're leading research in energy in Scotland. Scotland punches above its weight across the board. It always has. And I know that the future of Scotland will be built on the quality of its graduates. Regardless of their discipline, our students learn how to be innovative, enterprising, and creative, and they make a difference when they go into the workplace. I know that you, the class of 2015, will demonstrate the power of useful learning. I know you will make your dreams a reality, and I know you will make a difference to the world in which we all live. Thank you. I now declare closed this congregation for the conferment of degrees. I would like to invite our graduates to join the academic procession. Would family and friends please stay behind until the procession has left the building, and then you're welcome to join us in the Lord Todd for refreshments. Thank you.